佛说父母恩重难报经，白话解释简体版英文版回善书总目回主页。邀请三藏法师鸠摩罗什奉诏译 Go to English version of this sutra。 蓝色字原文，黑色字白话解释。如是我闻，这部经是我阿难亲自听佛陀宣讲的。一时佛在舍卫国之树给孤独园，与大比丘2500人，菩萨摩诃萨38000人聚。有一天，释迦牟尼佛在舍卫国止树给孤独园里说法，在场的有佛陀的常随弟子出家众2500人，与大菩萨摩诃萨38000人在一起听法。尔时，世尊引领大众直往南行，忽见路边巨骨一堆。尔时，如来向彼枯骨五体投地，恭敬礼拜。这时，世尊引导并带领大众弟子一直往南方行走，忽然看见路边聚集枯骨一堆。那时候，如来就对着那些枯骨行大礼，以五体投地的方式恭恭敬敬地顶礼膜拜。阿难合掌白言：世尊，如来是三界大师，四身慈父，众人归敬，以何因缘礼拜枯骨？阿难尊者合掌向佛陀禀白说：世上最尊贵的圣者，您是世间三界欲界、色界、无色界里的大导师，是母胎、蛋卵、巢师、变化胎、卵、湿、化四类众生的慈父，为众人所皈依敬仰，是由于什么因缘，世尊您竟然顶礼膜拜这些枯骨呢？佛告阿难：汝等虽是无上首弟子，出家日久，知识未广，此一堆枯骨或是我前世祖先多生父母，以是因缘我今礼拜。佛陀告诉阿难尊者说：你们虽然是我的上座首要弟子，出家修行的时日也很久了，但是所知道的事情还未广博。这一堆枯骨或者是我前世祖先的骨骸，或者是多生累世父母的遗骸。由于这个缘故，我今天才对着他们顶礼膜拜。佛告阿难：汝今将此一堆枯骨分作二分，若是男骨，色白且重；若是女骨，色黑且轻。佛陀又告诉阿难尊者说：你现今就将这一堆枯骨分作二份，如果是男人的骨骸，颜色会比较白而且比较重，如果是女人的骨骸，颜色则会比较黑而且比较轻。阿难白言：世尊，男人在世山戴鞋帽，装束严好，一望之为男子之身；女人在世多涂脂粉，或熏蓝舍，如是装饰，即得知是女流之身。而今死后，白骨一般，教弟子等如何认得？阿难尊者禀白佛陀说：世尊，男人活着的时候，身上的衫裤、腰带、鞋子、帽子等装束严整完好， 一望就知道是一位男子汉的身份。女人活着的时候，大多涂抹胭脂面粉，或是熏染兰香麝香，像这样的装饰打扮，立即就能够知道那是女流的身份。而现今他们死了以后，男女白骨都是一般样子，教我们弟子等怎么认得出是男是女呢？佛告阿难，若是男子，在世之时入瑜伽蓝，听讲经律，礼拜三宝，念佛名号，所以其骨色白且重，世间女人短于智力，意逆于情，生男育女，认为天职，每生一孩，赖乳养命，乳有血便，每孩以母八骨四豆甚多白乳，所以憔悴，骨现黑色，其量亦轻。佛陀告诉阿难尊者说，如果是男子，在世的时候多有进出迦兰佛寺，听讲佛经戒律，礼拜三宝，佛陀佛法，僧众口念佛的名号，所以他的骨骸颜色比较白，而且比较重。世间的女人大多短缺理智与脑力，容易沉溺于感情，把生男育女的事情认为是他的天赋职责，每生一个小孩都要依赖母乳来养活这婴孩的生命，乳汁是由血液变成的，每一个小孩都吸吮了母体中比八骨四豆还要多的白乳，所以母体憔悴消瘦，死后骨骸现出黑色，它的重量也比较轻。阿难闻语，痛割于心，垂泪悲泣，白言：世尊，母之恩德，云何报答？阿难尊者听闻了佛陀的话，心里痛楚的有如刀割一般，垂下眼泪，悲伤哭泣的禀白佛陀说：世尊呀，母亲的大恩大德，应该怎样才能报答呢？佛告阿难：汝今谛听，我当为汝分别解说。母胎怀子，凡经十月，甚为辛苦。在母胎时，第一月中，如草上株，朝不保木，成聚将来，午消散去。母怀胎时，第二月中，恰如凝酥。母怀胎时，第三月中，犹如凝血。母怀胎时，第四月中，稍作人形。母怀胎时，第五月中，而在母腹，身有五包，何者为五？头位一包，两肘两膝各位一包，共成五包。母怀胎时，第六月中，而在母腹，六经齐开，何者为六？眼为一经，耳为二经，鼻为三经，口为四经，舌为五经，意为六经。母怀胎时，第七月中，而在母腹，身成骨节，三百六十，即身毛乳，八万四千。母怀胎时，第八月中， 伸出一指，以及九窍。母怀胎时，第九月中，而在母腹吸收食物，所出各植桃梨蒜果五谷精华，其母身中，身脏向下，手脏向上，欲如地面，有山耸出，山有三名，一号须弥，二号夜山，三号血山，此设玉山，一度崩来，化为一条。母血凝成胎儿食料，母怀胎时，第十月中，孩儿全体一一完成，方乃降生。若是绝未孝顺之子，情权合掌，安详出生，不损伤母，母魔所苦。倘而绝为忤逆之子，破损母胎，扯母心肝，踏母胯骨，如千刀绞，又仿佛四万仞宰心，如斯重苦。出生此儿，更分析言，尚有十恩。佛陀告诉阿难尊者说，你现在仔细听着，我当会为你们分别说明清楚。母亲怀胎多数要经过十个月，是很辛苦的。胎儿在母腹的时候，第一个月里就像草上的露珠，清早出现，不一定能够保存到晚上，早晨聚集而来，中午就消失散去。母亲怀胎的时候，到第二个月，恰如凝聚的酥油。在母亲怀胎的时候，在第三个月，胎儿犹如像凝聚的血团。在母亲怀胎的时候，到第四个月，胎儿稍微长成人形。在母亲怀胎的时候，到第五个月，胎儿在母亲腹里已经生成有五部分的胞体。是哪五部分呢？就是头为一种胞体，两只手肘和两条腿膝各为一种胞体，一共成为五种胞体。在母亲怀胎的时候，到第六个月，胎儿在母亲的腹里，六种精气都已经齐全开通。是哪六种呢？眼睛是第一种，耳朵是第二种，鼻子是第三种，口嘴是第四种，舌头是第五种，心意是第六种。在母亲怀胎的时候，到第七个月，胎儿在母亲的腹里已经生成了筋骨关节，数目360，并且生长毛孔，数目约在84000。在母亲怀胎的时候，到第八个月，胎儿就生成意识脑质，以及眼睛两个瞳孔，两个耳孔，两个鼻孔，一个口腔，尿道和肛门等九个窍孔。在母亲怀胎的时候，到第九个月，胎儿在母亲的腹里已经能够吸收食物，所吸收的都是出自各种物质，像桃子、梨子、葱蒜、水果、五谷等的精华。在那母亲的身体里，身脏向下面，手脏向上扬，譬如在地面上有山耸然突出。山有三个名号，第一个名号叫做须弥山，第二个名号叫做夜山，第三个名号叫做血山。这些譬喻的山一次崩塌下来，就化为一条，母亲体内的血就凝集成了胎儿的食物。 在母亲怀胎的时候，到第十个月，孩儿的全部器官肢体都一一生长完成，方才降生下来。如果是决定作为孝顺的孩子，出胎的时候会擎起拳头做合拢手掌的状态，而安详顺利的出生，不会损伤母亲的身体，母亲没有太大痛苦。如果这孩儿决定是作为忤逆不孝的孩子，出胎的时候就会破坏损伤母亲的胎腹，双手抓扯母亲的心肝五脏，双脚踏踢母亲的胯下骨，使母亲痛苦的像千把刀在脚洞宰割，又仿佛好像万把利刃集中刺进母亲的心。像这样受尽极重大的痛苦，才出胎生下这孩儿。如果更进一步分类，明白的说，母亲还有十大恩德。第一，怀胎守护恩。第二，临产受苦恩。第三，生子忘忧恩。第四，咽苦吐甘恩。第五，回甘救失恩。第六，哺乳养育恩。第七，洗濯不净恩。第八，远行意念恩。第九，身家体恤恩。第十，就近怜悯恩。第一是母亲怀胎的时候对胎儿守卫爱护的恩德，第二是临盆生产受尽苦楚的恩德，第三是生下孩子就忘记所有痛苦的恩德，第四是自己咽下苦涩，吐出甘甜给予爱儿的恩德，第五是回施干净给予孩儿而自己将酒污湿的恩德，第六是抚慰乳奶和抚养教育的恩德，第七是替孩儿洗濯时尿不净的恩德，第八是孩儿外出远行，慈母在家挂心意念的恩德，第九是对孩儿深深加以体谅抚恤的恩德，第十是终身直到就近都没有穷尽对孩儿怜爱理念的恩德。第一，怀胎守护恩。宋曰：泪结因缘种，经来托母胎，月余生五脏，七七六经开，体重如山岳，动指结风灾，罗衣都不挂，装尽惹尘埃。第一，怀胎时守卫爱护的恩德，寄诵说：累世长劫造因结缘深重，今生才来寄托母亲怀胎。月又一月余过才生五脏，再过七个七天六经才开。胎儿体重压力就像山岳，胎一动一指向坏结风灾。母为胎儿罗衣都不想挂，化妆镜台也惹盖了尘埃。第二，临产受苦恩。宋曰：怀经十个月，难产将欲临，朝朝如重病，日日似昏神，难将黄布束，愁泪满胸襟，含悲告亲族，唯惧死来亲。第二，临盆生产受苦楚的恩德，寄诵说：母亲怀胎经过满十个月，苦难的生产即将要来临。早晨起床就像生了重病，天天神情闷重，好似昏沉。难将惶恐怖畏心情诉述，哀愁眼泪流满胸前衣襟，语调含悲告诉亲族家人，唯独惧怕死神夺而来亲。 第三，生子忘忧恩。宋曰：慈母生儿育，五脏总张开，身心俱闷绝，血流似涂阳。身以闻而见，欢喜倍加长，喜定悲还至，痛苦彻心肠。第三，生了儿子忘记忧苦的恩德。寄颂说，当慈母生产儿子的日子，五脏总都像要破裂撕开，身体心神即要闷绝而死，鲜血直流，好似屠宰猪羊。生下以后，听闻爱而安见，心情欢喜更加倍于往常。欢喜暂歇，然而悲痛又到，难忍痛苦又在贯彻心肠。第四，厌苦吐甘恩。宋曰：父母恩深重，故怜梅失时，吐甘无少席，厌苦不平梅，爱重情难忍，恩深父辈悲，但令孩儿饱，慈母不慈饥。第四，咽下苦味，吐出甘甜，给予爱儿的恩德。寄颂说，父母恩德高深且又重大，照顾怜爱从不疏忽失时，吐甘味而没有稍作停息，自己咽下苦涩从不皱眉，爱重味而心情愁苦难忍，恩情深忧心又加倍伤悲，但望能令孩儿吃饱满足，慈母不辞，自愿挨饿受饥。第五，回甘救师恩。宋曰：母愿身投师，将儿于旧前，两乳充饥渴，罗袖掩风寒，恩怜横废枕，宠弄才能欢，但令孩儿稳，慈母不求安。第五，回儿于甘，自己救师的恩德。寄颂说，母亲甘愿自身投于巫师，而将爱儿遗救于近且前，两个母乳专为儿充饥渴，青罗衣袖用来掩儿风寒，恩爱怜惜恒常费枕不眠，宠爱逗母才能感到心欢，但愿能令孩儿获得安稳，慈母总不为己寻求平安。第六，哺乳养育恩。宋曰：慈母向大地，严父配于天，父载恩同等，父娘恩亦然，不憎无怒目，不嫌手足挛，但父亲生子，终日习兼连。第六，哺喂乳乃抚养教育的恩德。寄颂说，慈母让儿依靠就像大地，严父养育儿女可配于天，天父的宰养育万物恩同，父母养儿恩德也是同然，不厌丑陋，更无怨恨怒目，不弃孩儿手足罹患痉挛，对从母父诞生亲生子女，好坏都是整天珍惜爱怜。第七，洗涤不敬恩。宋曰：本是芙蓉植，精神健且丰，眉分心柳碧，脸色夺莲红，恩深催玉茂，洗濯损盘龙，只为怜男女，慈母感颜容。第七，洗濯而时尿不尽的恩德。寄颂说，母体本来就像荷花芙蓉，精神气色原本健壮且丰， 两眉分开就像新柳翠碧，红颜脸色胜夺莲花粉红。对儿恩爱深深摧残玉帽，洗濯不尽损伤手盘五龙。只为怜爱男孩以及女儿，慈母手粗脸皱改变颜容。第八，远情意念恩。宋曰：死别成难忍，生离时亦伤。子出关山外，母亦在他乡。日夜心相随，流泪数千行。如元气爱子，寸寸断肝肠。第八，儿女远情深重意念的恩德。寄颂说：死亡永别母心成属难忍，在生离家着时亦感悲伤。儿子远情渡出关爱山外，母亦挂念担心遥远他乡。日夜母心相随离家游子，其心担忧流泪已数千行。如同猿猴哭泣离别爱子，伤心难过寸寸哭断肝肠。第九，身家体恤恩。宋曰：父母恩情重，恩深报时难。子苦怨待受，儿老母不安。闻道远情去，怜儿夜卧寒。男女暂辛苦，常使母心酸。第九，身家体贴和抚恤的恩德。寄颂说：父母对儿恩情极其重大，恩德深重，报恩实在困难。子受苦难，父母愿代替受，孩儿辛劳，母心疼惜不安。听闻子女就要远行出去，怜爱儿心夜卧深觉孤寒。男孩女儿短暂受到辛苦，就会长时使令父母心酸。第十，就近怜悯恩。宋曰：父母恩深重，恩怜无歇时，起坐心相逐，静遥一语随。母年一百岁，常忧八十儿。欲知恩爱断，命尽始分离。第十，就近无穷怜悯的恩德。寄颂说：父母恩德高深且又重大，给儿恩惠怜爱无停歇时。起立坐下，母心都相跟逐，接近或是遥远挂念共随。老母年龄即使已一百岁，仍然常常担忧八十岁儿。想知对儿恩爱何时断绝，命尽死了恩爱心才分离。佛告阿难：我观众生虽少人品，心行愚蒙，不思爹娘，有大恩德，不生恭敬，忘恩背义，无有仁慈，不孝不顺。阿娘怀子十月之中，起坐不安，如情重担，饮食不下，如常病人，月闷生时，受诸痛苦，须臾产出，恐已无常，如杀猪羊，血流遍地，受如是苦，生得而生，咽苦吐甘，抱持养育，洗濯不尽，不但劬劳，忍寒忍热，不辞辛苦，甘处而卧，失处母眠。三年之中，应母白血，因孩童子， 佛陀又告诉阿难尊者说，我观察到很多众生虽然传承了作为人子的品格良心善行，却受愚痴蒙蔽，不思念父母爹娘，于生育儿女有大恩德，不产生恭敬父母的心，忘了父母的恩德，又违背了人子的道义，没有仁爱慈悲的心肠，忤逆不孝不顺从父母。做母亲的阿娘怀孕生子，在十个月怀胎的期间中，起立坐下都感到不安，向情负着重担，三餐饮食也吃不下，就像患了长期疾病的人。十月期满临盆生产的时候，受尽诸般的痛苦，在片刻的须臾间已产出婴儿，心又恐惧无常，死神又要来侵夺。这时就像宰杀了猪羊，母体血流遍满地面，受了像这样的苦楚，才生产得到孩儿身体，从此自己吞咽苦涩而吐出甘味来喂食爱儿，怀抱扶持养育婴儿，为儿洗濯屎尿等不干净的秽物，不但为辛劳，自己忍受着寒冷，忍受着炎热，不推辞任何辛苦。干净的地方让爱儿睡过，尿湿污秽的地方慈母自己躺着睡眠。哺乳喂奶的三年期间中，孩子都是喝饮母体白色鲜血的乳汁，乃至成年。教导礼义，婚嫁淫谋，被求资业，协和艰辛，勤苦百倍，不言恩惠。从婴孩抚养成少年的童子，乃至成年壮大，教导处事的礼节义理，为儿女完成婚姻嫁娶，帮助孩子经营事业谋生，多方谋求资财和业务，提携子女并荷负重担是非常艰难辛苦，虽然殷勤受苦几百倍，也不说起自己对儿女的恩惠。男女有病，父母惊忧，忧及生病，视同常事，子若病除，母病方悦，如斯养育，愿早成人，及其长成，反为不孝，尊亲语言，不知顺从，应对无礼，恶眼相视。男孩女儿有了病，父母心里就惊慌担忧，常为儿女担忧至极而生病，却把自己的病视同很平常的事情。子女如果病患除去好了，父母因为担忧所引起的病也才痊愈好了起来。像这样辛苦的养育，但愿儿女早日长大成人。可是有些儿女等到他们长大成人，不但不报答父母恩德，反而忤逆不孝，本应受到尊敬的父母双亲对他说话，都不知道应该顺从父母的意思，面对父母应答对话毫无礼貌，甚至用凶恶的眼光相向仇视。欺凌伯叔，打骂兄弟，毁辱亲情，无有礼义，虽曾从学，不遵范训，父母教令多不依从，兄弟共言，每相为利，出入来往，不起尊堂，言行高傲，善意未事，父母训罚，伯叔与非，同幼怜悯，尊人遮护，渐渐成长，狠戾不调， 不服亏为，反生甜恨，弃诸亲友，朋负恶人，喜酒成性，任非为事。在家族中欺负凌辱上辈的伯父叔，打骂同胞的兄弟，毁伤侮辱亲族情谊，言行丝毫没有礼貌仁义。虽然曾经从老师读书学习，可是不遵守规范训诲，父母的教训命令多不依照所说顺从去做，兄弟共同劝勉，每每相互违逆敌对，出外入内朋友来往都不会起禀告知父母，言语行为自傲自大，擅出主意，胡作非为，从小做错受父母教训处罚，或伯父叔父说他的不对，由于孩童年幼使人怜爱悯惜，长辈们就遮掩袒护他，孩子渐渐成年长大，成了凶狠暴力而不能调伏，不承认自己所犯下亏心违法的罪行，反而心生甜怒怨恨，弃绝那些亲人益友，而去交结依附歹徒恶人做朋友，习惯久了成了恶性，颠倒是非，认为非法犯罪是应该，或被人诱逃往他乡，违背爹娘，离家别眷，或因经济，或为政行，仍染阴循，便未婚娶，游思留爱，久不还家，或在他乡不能谨慎，被人谋害，横事勾牵，枉被刑责，牢狱枷锁，或遭病患，恶难迎缠，穷苦积累，无人看待，被人嫌贱，尾气皆渠，因此命中无人救治，膨胀烂坏，日暴风吹，白骨飘零，寄他乡土，便与亲族欢会长乖，违背慈恩，不知二老，永怀忧念，或因啼泣，眼暗目盲，或因悲哀，气咽成病，或缘一子，衰变死亡，做鬼报魂，不曾割舍，或者被人拐骗诱惑，逃往遥远的他乡，为别背弃自己的爹娘父母而不顾，离了家人，别了眷属，或者因为经商买卖，或为官府正式远行，时光荏苒而过，因循耽误未归，便不经父母同意在外结婚娶妻，由于这样停留在外，阻碍归程，长久不能还家照顾父母，或在他乡异国，自己不能够小心谨慎，被坏人用计谋陷害，恨或官事勾缠牵连，被官府冤枉而用刑责罚，或被关入牢狱，用木枷套住颈项，用手铐脚镣锁住手脚，或遭遇到疾病祸患，被灾厄苦难淫戏缠身，成了囚犯，被人拘禁受苦，饥饿消瘦羸弱，没有亲人看顾招待，或被人嫌他会贱，抛弃于街头马路，因此直到命中气绝，都没有亲人去救助治疗，而且死在野外，身体膨胀臭烂腐坏，一直受到太阳曝晒雨打风吹，终于白骨飘零，没有人收埋，寄魂他乡异土，便和亲人家族永远长别乖违，而且违背辜负父母慈爱养育的恩德和寄望， 在外不知道父母二位老人在家，对游子永远怀着担忧和思念。父母或因思念子女长期啼哭悲泣，眼睛渐暗而目盲失明，或因伤心悲哀过度闷气呜咽而成疾病，或源于意念爱子万念俱灰无心事业而家道衰落导致灾变而死亡，虽然死了作鬼，也都仍然不曾割断舍弃爱儿之心。或父闻子不从学业，烹煮一端，无赖粗顽，好习无益，斗打窃盗，触犯乡闾，饮酒出仆，奸非过失，带累兄弟，恼乱爹娘，臣去暮骸，不问尊亲，动指寒温，会朔朝暮，永乖服侍，安床见枕，并不知闻，参问起居，从此间断，父母年迈，形貌衰羸，羞耻见人，忍受欺役。或又听闻儿子不崇尚学问事业，追随坏朋友惹生异端，成了无赖的游民，粗野顽劣，喜好学习有害无益的坏事，整天斗争打架偷窃或做抢劫的强盗，触恼侵犯乡里百姓，饮酒赌博，作奸犯科，为非作歹，犯了很多罪恶过失，连带的拖累了同胞兄弟，恼怒扰乱了爹娘父母的心。早晨出去游荡，暮晚半夜才归还，从不关心过问父母双亲他们的起居行动或寒冻温暖。月尾月初朝晨暮晚，永远乖违了作为人子扶持侍奉年老双亲的义务。父母安眠的床铺草席枕头，也都不去过问料之关怀，然而餐夜问候父母的饮食起居，从此间断消失。父母年迈老病，形体容貌衰老消瘦羸弱，家中出了不孝子，父母羞耻不敢出门见人，而忍受着旁人的耻笑指责与欺负。或有父孤母寡，独守空堂，犹若客人，寄居他舍，寒冻饥渴，曾不知闻，昼夜长啼，自嗟自叹，应奉干旨，供养尊亲，若被忘人，冷漠世事，每作羞惭，为人怪笑。或有的母亲已死父守寡，或父已死母孤单，孤独寂寞地守着空堂冷室，犹如不认识的外来客人，寄居在别人的屋舍，受着寒冷冰冻，饥饿口渴，儿女都不曾去听闻料知过问。可怜的老人于白天夜晚常常悲伤啼哭，自己感慨命不好而独自叹息。儿女本应奉上甘旨美味，供给侍养父母双亲，可是像这被妄动不孝的人，到头终了却没做半件孝顺事。父母为此每每想起就羞耻惭愧而感叹，畏惧别人责怪耻笑而不敢见人。或持财时供养妻儿，妄觉疲劳，无必羞耻，妻妾约束，每事依从，尊长甜喝，全无畏惧。有的拿着钱财美食供给养育自己的妻子儿女，忘了所有的疲倦辛劳，但却冷落父母， 没有未必被人羞骂耻笑不孝的心。妻子每妾所约束的话，大小每一件事情都必定依照顺从，而对父母或长辈的甜怒呵责，完全没有一点畏惧尊重。或父是女，是配他人，未嫁之时，先皆孝顺，婚嫁已弃，不孝遂增，父母为田，即生怨恨，夫婿打骂，忍受甘心，异性他宗，情深眷重，自家骨肉，却以为叔，或随夫婿，外郡他乡，离别爹娘，无心恋慕，断绝消息，音信不通，遂使爹娘悬肠挂肚，客不能安，宛若倒悬，每思见面，如可思将，慈念后人，无有休息，父母恩德无量无边，不孝之谦，猝难成报。或者又有女儿嫁到夫家，在还未嫁出去的时候都很孝顺亲生父母，结婚嫁出去以后，不孝之心遂而增加，父母稍微甜怒责骂，女儿心里即刻产生怨恨，做她丈夫的女婿再怎么打骂她，她却能忍受甘心。对丈夫家不同姓氏的别家宗亲，眷属情爱深重，而对自己老家亲生父母骨肉，却疏远忘掉。有的女儿或跟随她的夫婿住到遥远的外郡他乡，离别了亲生的父母爹娘，却毫无依恋思慕亲生父母，从此断绝了消息，一点寄音书信都不通报，遂使父母爹娘日夜思念而悬肠挂肚，每一时刻都不能够安下心来，那日子的难过就像身体被颠倒悬挂着，每天思念想要见面，就像喉咙干渴在思念水浆。父母慈心思念儿女，永远没有休止停息，父母的大恩大德无法计量，没有边际，儿女不孝的罪愆到最终都很难陈述报告得了。尔时大众闻佛所说父母重恩，举身投地，堆胸自扑，身毛孔中，膝间流血，闷绝壁地，良久乃苏，高声唱言：苦哉苦哉，痛哉痛哉，我等今者身是罪人，从来未觉，明若夜游，今悟之悲，心感俱碎，唯愿世尊哀悯救援，云何报的父母深恩。那时候大众弟子听闻了佛陀所说父母的深重恩德，感动的举起全身头伏地面，有的用手堆着胸部自己扑打自责，身体的毛孔里都流出了鲜血，闷绝晕倒于的脚步不能行动，过了很久才苏醒，于是高声喊叫说：苦恼呀苦恼呀，痛心呀痛心呀，我们今天都是罪孽深重的人了，从来未曾发觉父母恩德，心里愚暗的像一个夜游的人，今天才觉悟了知过去不孝的错误， 痛苦难过的心脏肝胆都要碎裂。唯一祈愿世尊哀怜悯念拯救援助我们，只是我们怎样才能报答得了父母深重的恩德呢？尔时，如来即以八种深重梵音告诸大众：汝等当知，我今为汝分别解说。假使有人左肩担父，右肩担母，眼皮至骨，穿骨至髓，绕须弥山，经百千劫，血流绝踝，犹不能报父母深恩。这时候，如来就用极好的声音、柔美的声音、和其安适的声音、尊贵智慧的声音、不带女人音的声音、不物言的声音、深远洪亮的声音、不雅洁的声音等八种佛所证的深远隆重的清净梵音，告诉诸位大众弟子说：你们应当知道，我今天就为你们分门别类来解说。假使有一个人，左边的肩膀上挑担着父亲，右边的肩膀上又挑担着母亲，两肩重担眼破皮肉以致见骨，甚至磨穿肩骨见到骨髓，绕着须弥山行走，这样经过几百几千个长劫时间，即使血流闷的淹没了脚跟足踝，还是不能报答得了父母深重的恩德。假使有人遭饥警劫，喂于爹娘，尽其己身，鸾歌碎坏，犹如围城，经百千劫，犹不能报父母深恩。假使有一个人遭遇到荒年受着饥馑挨饿的灾劫，唯恐爹娘父母饿死，将自己全身切割成碎块的肉酱，就像维系尘埃那么细碎来让父母充饥，像这样经过几百几千个长劫时间，还是不能报答得了父母深重的恩德。假使有人喂于爹娘，手执利刀，弯起眼睛，现于如来，经百千劫，犹不能报父母深恩。假使有一个人想要布施供佛为父母爹娘求福天寿，手里直拿锐利的刀剑，弯刮自己的眼睛，奉献给如来，生生世世都这样做，经过了几百几千个长劫时间，还是不能报答得了父母深重的恩德。假使有人喂于爹娘，亦以利刀割其心肝，血流遍地，不辞痛苦，经百千劫，犹不能报父母深恩。假使有一个人为了自己的父母爹娘，也用锐利的刀刃割下他自己的心脏肝脏，鲜血流出遍满地上，都不会为切推辞痛苦，生生世世都这样做，经过了几百几千个长劫时间，还是不能报答得了父母深重的恩德。假使有人喂于爹娘，百千刀戟，一时刺身，于自身中左右出入，经百千劫，犹不能报父母深恩。假使有一个人为了自己的父母爹娘受到百千把刀剑或枪戟同一时刻刺进身体，并在自己的身体里从左右两边出入刺杀，这样经过几百几千个长劫时间， 还是不能报答得了父母深重的恩德。假使有人位于爹娘，大故出孙，经百千劫，犹不能报父母深恩。假使有一个人为了自己的父母爹娘，打断筋骨流出骨髓，生生世世都这样做，经过几百几千个长劫时间，还是不能报答得了父母深重的恩德。假使有人喂于爹娘，吞热铁丸，经百千劫，变身焦烂，犹不能报父母深恩。假使有一个人为了自己的父母爹娘，吞下烧热的铁丸，经过了几百几千个长劫时间，便满全身都烧焦腐烂，还是不能报答得了父母深重的恩德。尔时大众闻佛所说父母恩德，垂泪悲泣，痛割于心，地思无忌，同发声言，深深惭愧，共白佛言：世尊，我等今者身是罪人，云何报得父母深恩？这时候大众弟子听闻了佛陀所说父母的大恩大德，都垂下眼泪，悲伤的哭泣，痛心疾首，就像利刀割心。详细思考都想不出报答父母深恩的好计策，于是共同发出声音说话，心里深深的升起惭愧心。大家共同禀白佛陀说：世上最尊的圣者，我们今天都是不孝罪很深的人，究竟要怎样才能报答得了父母深重的恩德呢？佛告弟子：欲得报恩，为于父母书写此经，为于父母读诵此经，为于父母忏悔罪愆，为于父母供养三宝，为于父母受持斋戒，为于父母布施修福。若能如是，则得名为孝顺之子，不作此行，是地狱人。佛陀告诉弟子们说，想要报答得了父母的深恩，应该为自己父母书写这一本经典，为父母读诵这一本经典，在佛前为父母忏悔一切罪愆，为父母去佛寺奉献供养代表佛教的佛陀、佛法、僧众等三宝，为父母皈依素食持斋受戒，为父母布施行善救济孤苦贫困，来修增父母福寿。如果能够像这样去做，就可以叫做孝顺的子女，不做这些善行的人，就是不孝子，将来必定是堕地狱的人。佛告阿难：不孝之人，身坏命中，堕于阿鼻无间地狱。此大地狱，纵广八万由旬，四面铁城，周围罗网，其地一铁，圣火动燃，猛烈火烧，雷奔电烁，羊铜铁枝，浇灌罪人，铜狗铁蛇，横吐烟火，焚烧主志，枝高焦燃，苦痛哀哉，难堪难忍，钩竿枪槊，铁枪铁铲，铁锤铁戟，剑树刀纹，如雨如云，空中而下，或斩或刺，苦乏罪人。 历劫受殃，无时暂歇，又令更入于诸地狱，头戴火盆，铁车碾身，纵横驶过，肠肚分裂，骨肉焦烂，一日之中千生万死，受如是苦，皆因前生忤逆不孝，故获死罪。佛陀告诉阿难尊者说，忤逆不孝父母的人，命中体坏时，就堕入阿鼻无间地狱去饱受苦刑。这一个大地狱，纵横长广有八万由旬那么大，四面围着很高的铁城，四周上扬都围着牢固的罗网。那地面上也是铁质，盛大的猛火上下通彻的燃烧着，猛烈的火焰到处焚烧着，霹雳的雷声遍人奔跑，闪电不断的闪烁着。地狱里的夜叉鬼阳化了铜铁的红汁，浇灌着受苦刑的罪人，铜狗铁蛇一直不断吐出烟和火，或焚烧或煮制着罪人，使罪人身体的脂肪高油焦烂而燃烧起来，苦痛哀哭，难以堪当，难以忍受。半空中有挂钩的大钩杆，又有尖枪长矛飞下来刺杀罪人，满玉铁身喷枪，铁器连串，铁锤和尖枪铁戟，剑术和轮刀利器，闷空飞驰，多的像下雨又像云林，由空中射下来，或用刀斩，或用矛刺，苦惨的刑罚着罪人。这样经历了很多长劫的时间，还在受着苦刑的灾殃，而且没有片刻可以暂时休歇。接着又令这些罪人进入其余的各种地狱继续受苦刑，或头上戴着燃烧的火盆，或用铁车碾压罪人的身体，或南北或东西纵横碾压而过，使罪人的肠肚都分开碎裂，骨头和皮肉都烧焦腐烂，在一天的时间里就经过几千万次的苦刑死去了，忽然经过风吹水淋而又苏醒活来。他们之所以会受到如此凄惨的苦刑，都是因为前生在世的时候犯了杀害父亲、杀害母亲、杀害证了阿罗汉果的圣者、破坏佛寺和合的僧众、损伤佛身使佛流血等五种大逆不道和不孝，所以获得这么重的罪苦。尔时，大众闻佛所说父母恩德，垂泪悲泣，告于如来：我等今者，云何报得父母深恩？这时候，大众弟子听闻了佛陀所说父母的大恩大德，都垂下眼泪，悲伤的哭泣，请示于如来说：我们现今应该怎样才能报答得了父母深重的恩德呢？佛告弟子：欲得报恩，为于父母造此经典，是真报的父母恩也。能造一卷，得见一佛；能造十卷，得见十佛；能造百卷，得见百佛；能造千卷，得见千佛；能造万卷，得见万佛。是等善人造经立故，是诸佛等常来慈护，历使其人生生父母得生天上，受诸快乐，离地狱苦。佛陀告诉弟子们说，想要真正报答得了父母的大恩， 最好就是为父母书写印造这一部经典，这才真正能够报答得了父母养育的大恩呀。能够印造这部经典一本，就能遇见一位佛；能够印造十本，就能遇见十位佛；能够印造一百本，就能遇见一百位佛；能够印造一千本，就能遇见一千位佛；能够印造一万本，就能遇见一万位佛。这些孝顺而善心的人，因为印造佛经所得功德力量的缘故，这些诸佛们都会恒常来用慈光照顾，立即使这些人和生育他们的父母都能升到天上，享受着各种快乐，而脱离地狱的罪苦。尔时，阿难及诸大众，阿修罗、迦楼罗、紧那罗、摩侯罗迦人、非人等，天龙、夜叉、干闼婆及诸小王，转轮圣王，是诸大众闻佛所言，身毛皆竖，悲泣哽咽，不能自裁，各发怨言：我等从今敬畏埋祭，宁遂此身犹如为尘，经百千劫，誓不为于如来圣教。宁以铁钩拔出其舌，常有游寻，铁犁根之，血流成河，经百千劫，誓不为于如来圣教。宁以百千刀纹于自身中，自由出入，誓不为于如来圣教。宁以铁网周匝缠身，经百千劫，誓不为于如来圣教。宁以错对斩碎其身，百千万段，皮肉筋骨悉皆零落，经百千劫，终不为于如来圣教。这时候，阿难尊者以及诸位大众弟子，乃至阿修罗、迦楼罗、金翅鸟、歌神紧那罗、地龙摩侯罗迦、四人非人等，天神、龙众、夜叉鬼、乐神干闼婆，以及诸位小国王、转轮圣王等等，这些广大的群众听闻了佛陀所说的话，身体的毛发都竖立起来，内心愧疚而悲伤，哭泣哽咽，不能自止，于是在佛前个人发出誓愿说：我们从今天起以至穷尽未来十世的边际，宁可粉碎这个身体，就像维系尘埃那么细碎，这样经过几百千个长劫时间，都立誓绝不违背于如来神圣的教诲而不孝，宁可被铁钩拔出舌头，拉得有一游寻那么长，再被铁犁在舌上根犁，鲜血流成一条河，像这样经过几百千个长劫时间，也立誓绝不违背于如来神圣的教诲而不孝，宁可被几百千个转动的刀纹在自己的身体中自由出入刺砍，也立誓绝不违背于如来神圣的教诲而不孝，宁可被铁网从四周围扎绕缠绞着身体，经过几百千个长劫时间，也立誓不违背于如来神圣的教诲而不孝，宁可被错刀斩磨捣碎身体成百千万段，皮肉筋骨尽都零散脱落，像这样经过几百千个长劫时间，到最终仍然立誓绝不违背于如来神圣的教诲而不孝。尔时，阿难从于座中安详而起，白佛言：世尊，此经当何名之？ 云何奉持？这时候，阿难尊者从座位当中安详的起立，请示佛陀说：世尊，这一本经典应当用什么名字来称呼呢？应该怎样去奉行和受持呢？佛告阿难，此经名为父母恩重难报经，以是名字，汝当奉持。佛陀告诉阿难尊者说，这一本经典名字叫做父母恩重难报经，就用这个名字，你们应当依照此经奉行和受持。尔时，大众、天人、阿修罗等闻佛所说，皆大欢喜，信受奉行，作礼而退。这时候，大众弟子们、天人以及阿修罗等天龙八部众，听闻了佛陀所说的话，都升起很大的欢喜心，信仰接受，尊奉实行，一一行礼而退去。转载自报佛恩网 http://www.namomotap.net/chapter/publication/fillyalpitisutra/chapter.htm 等于等于等于等于等于等于等于等于等于等于等于等于等于等于等于等于繁体中文版简体中文版回善书总目回主页。The Buddha speaks the sutra about the deep kindness of parents and the difficulty in repaying it. 佛说父母恩重难报经。Download the English article 下载英文版 Filial Piety Sutra 小经 Translated by Upasika Kari Mikosan Reviewed by Pishanai Hanta Edited by Pishanai Han Chapter IHN Upasika Susan Runt Certified byVenerable Abbot Wan Piksu Nihanta. Thus I have heard, at one time, the Buddha, Pho, dwelt at Shravasti, Shi Wei Guo, in the Jeta Grove, in the garden of the benefactor of orphans and the solitary, Gu Du Yuan, together with a gathering of a great Pikshus, Da Bi Qiu.1250 in all, and with all of the Bodhisattvas, 菩萨摩诃萨 38,000 in all. At that time, the world honored one, 世尊, led the great assembly, 大众, on a walk toward the south. Suddenly they came upon a pile of bones beside the road.The world-honored one, 世尊, turned to face them, placed his five legs on the ground, and bowed respectfully. Amanda put his palms together and asked the world-honored one, 世尊, the Tathagatha is the great teacher of the Triple Realm and the compassionate father of beings of the four kinds of births.He has the respect and reverence of the entire assembly. What is the reason that he now goes to a pile of dry bones? The Buddha, Pho, told Amanda, Anan, although all of you are my foremost disciples and have been members at the Sangha, Jialan, for a long time,You still have not achieved far-reaching understanding. This pile of bones could have belonged to my ancestors from former lives. That is the reason I now bow to many past lives. That is the reason I now bow to them. The Buddha, 佛, continued speaking to Ananda, 阿难。These bones we are looking at can be divided into two groups. One group is composed of the bones of men, which are heavy and white in color. Another group is composed of the bones of women, which are light and black in color. Ananda, 阿难, said to the Buddha, 佛, world honored one, 世尊, when men are alive in the world, they adorn their bodies with robes, belts, shoes, hats and other fine attire, so that they clearly assume a male appearance. When women are alive, they put on cosmetics, perfume, powders, and elegant fragrances to adorn their bodies, so that they clearly assume a female appearance. Yet, once men and women die, all that is left are their bones. How does one tell them apart? Please teach us how you are able to distinguish them. The Buddha, 佛, answered Ananda, 阿难, if when men are in the world, they enter into temples, listen to explanations of sutras, 经, and Vinaya, 律, texts, make obeisance to the triple jewel, Sangha, and recite the Buddha's names, then when they die their bones will be heavy and white in color. Most women in the world have little wisdom and are saturated with emotion. They give birth to and raise children, feeling that this is their duty. Each child relies on its mother as milk for life and nourishment, and that milk is a transformation of the mother as blood. Each child drinks 1,200 gallons of its mother as milk. Because of this drain on the mother as body whereby the child takes milk for its nourishment, the mother becomes worn and haggard and so her bones turn black in color and are light in weight. When Ananda, 阿难, heard these words, he felt a pain in his heart as if he had been stabbed and wept silently. He said to the world honored one, 世尊, how can one repay one as mother, as kindness and virtue? The Buddha, 佛, told Ananda, 阿难, listen well, and I will explain it for you in detail. The fetus grows in its mother as womb for 10 lunar months. What bitterness she goes through while it dwells there. In the first month of pregnancy, the life of the fetus is as precarious as a dewdrop on grass. How likely that it will not last from morning to evening but will evaporate by midday. During the second lunar month, the embryo congeals like curds. In the third month it is like coagulated blood. During the fourth month of pregnancy the fetus begins to assume a slightly human form. During the fifth month in the womb, the child has five limbs, two legs, two arms, and a head start to take shape. In the sixth lunar month of pregnancy, the child begins to develop the essences of the six sense faculties, the eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body and mind. During the seventh month, the 360 bones and joints are formed, and the 84,000 hair pores are also complete. In the 8 months, the fetus has learned to assimilate the different nutrients of the foods it eats. For example, it can assimilate the essence of peaches, pears, certain plant roots, and the 5 kinds of grains. Inside the mother's body, the solid internal organs, used for storing, head downward, while the hollow internal organs, used for processing, spiral upward. These can be likened to 3 mountains which arise from the face of the earth. We can call these mountains Mount Suvaru, Xuni, Karma Mountain, Yeshan, and Blood Mountain, Qishan. These analogous mountains come together and form a single range in a pattern of upward peaks and downward valleys. So, too, the coagulation of the mother, as blood from her internal organs forms a single substance which becomes the child, as food. During the 10th month of pregnancy, the body of the fetus is completed and ready to be born. If the child is extremely filial, it will emerge with palms joined together in respect and the birth will be peaceful and auspicious. The mother will remain uninjured by the birth and will not suffer pain. However, if the child is extremely rebellious in nature, to the extent that it is capable of committing the 5 rebellious acts, then it will injure its mother, as womb, rip apart its mother, as heart and liver, or get entangled in its mother, as bones. The birth will feel like the slices of 1,000 knives or like 10,000 sharp swords stabbing her heart. Those are the agonies involved in the birth of a defiant and rebellious child. Note, 5 rebellious acts, 5逆罪, are patricide, 杀父, matricide, 杀母, murdering a sage, 杀阿修罗, breaking up the Sangha, 破和合僧, and shedding the Buddha's blood, 出佛身血. To explain more clearly, there are 10 types of kindness bestowed by the mother on the child. The first is the kindness of providing protection and care while the child is in the womb. The second is the kindness of bearing suffering during the birth. The third is the kindness of forgetting all the pain once the child has been born. The fourth is the kindness of eating the bitter herself and saving the sweet for the child. The fifth is the kindness of moving the child to a dry place and lying in the wet herself. The sixth is the kindness of suckling the child at her breast and nourishing and bringing up the child. The seventh is the kindness of washing away the unclean. The eighth is the kindness of always thinking of the child when it has traveled far. The ninth is the kindness of deep care and devotion. The tenth is the kindness of ultimate pity and sympathy. E. The kindness of providing protection and care while the child is in the womb. The causes and conditions from accumulated culpas, jie, grows heavy. Until in this life the child ends up in its mother's womb. As the months pass, the 5 vital organs develop. Within 7 weeks, the sixth sense organs start to grow. The mother's body becomes as heavy as a mountain. The stillness and movements of the fetus are like a Celtic wind disaster. The mother's fine clothes no longer hang properly. And so her mirror gathers dust. The kindness of bearing suffering during birth. The pregnancy lasts for 10 lunar months and culminates in difficult labor at the approach of the birth. Meanwhile, each morning the mother is seriously ill and during every day is drowsy and sluggish. Her fear and agitation are difficult to describe. Grieving and tears fill her breast. She painfully tells her family that she is only afraid that death will overtake her. Then, the kindness of forgetting all the pain once the child has been born. On the day the compassionate mother bears the child, her five organs all open wide, leaving her totally exhausted in body and mind. The blood flows as from a slaughtered lamb. Yet, upon hearing that the child is healthy, she is overcome with redoubling joy. But after the joy, the grief returns, and the agony wrenches her very insides. 四, the kindness of eating the bitter herself and saving the sweet for the child. The kindness of both parents is profound and deep. Their care and devotion never cease, never resting. The mother saves the sweet for the child, and without complaint she swallows the bitter herself. Her love is weighty and her emotion difficult to bear. Her kindness is deep and so is her compassion, only wanting the child to get its fill. The compassionate mother does to speak of her own hunger. 五, the kindness of moving the child to a dry place and lying in the wet herself. The mother is willing to be wet, so that the child can be dry. With her two breasts she satisfies its hunger and thirst. Covering it with her sleeve, she protects it from the wind and cold. In kindness, her head rarely rests on the pillow. And yet she does this happily. So long as the child is comfortable, the kind mother seeks no solace for herself. 六, the kindness of suckling the child at her breast and nourishing and bringing up the child. The kind mother is like the great earth. The stern father is like the encompassing heaven. One covers from above, the other supports from below. The kindness of parents is such that they know no hatred or anger toward their offspring, and are not displeased, even if the child is born crippled. After the mother carries the child in her womb and gives birth to it, the parents care for and protect it together until the end of their days. 七, the kindness of washing away the unclean. Originally she had a pretty face and a beautiful body. Her spirit was strong and vibrant. Her eyebrows were like fresh green willows. And her complexion would have put a red rose to shame. But her kindness is so deep she will forego a beautiful face. Although washing away the filth injures her constitution. The kind mother acts solely for the sake of her sons and daughters. And willingly allows her beauty to fade. 八, the kindness of always thinking of the child when it has traveled far. The death of loved ones is difficult to endure. But separation is also painful. When the child travels afar, the mother worries in her village. From morning until night, her heart is with her child. And a thousand tears fall from her eyes. Like the monkey weeping silently in love for her child. Bit, boy, bit, her heart is broken. 九, the kindness of deep care and devotion. How happy is the parent's kindness and emotional concern? Their kindness is deep and difficult to repay. Willingly they undergo suffering on their child's behalf. If the child toils, the parents are uncomfortable. If they hear that he has traveled afar, they worry that at night he will have to lie in the cold. Even in moment, as pain suffered by their sons or daughters, will cause the parents sustained distress. 十, the kindness of ultimate pity and sympathy. The kindness of parents is profound and important. Their tender concern never ceases. From the moment they awake each day, their thoughts are with their children. Whether the children are near or far away, the parents think of them often. Even if a mother lives for 100 years, she will constantly worry about her 80-year-old child. Do you wish to know when such kindness and love ends? It doesn't even begin to dissipate until her life is over. The Buddha, Phu, told Amanda, Anan, when I contemplate living beings, I see that although they are born as human beings, nonetheless, they are stupid and dull in their actions. They don't consider their parents' great kindness and virtue. They are disrespectful and turn their backs on kindness and what is right. They lack humanness and are neither filial nor compliant. For 10 months while the mother is with child, she feels discomfort each time she rises, as if she were lifting a heavy burden. Like a chronic invalid, she is unable to keep her food and drink down. When the 10 months have passed and the time comes for the birth, she undergoes all kinds of pain and suffering so that the child can be born. She is afraid of her own mortality, like a pig or lamb waiting to be slaughtered. Then the blood flows all over the ground. These are the sufferings she undergoes. Once the child is born, she saves what is sweet for him and swallows what is bitter herself. She carries the child and nourishes it, washing away its filth. There is no toil or difficulty that she does not willingly undertake for the sake of her child. She endures both cold and heat and never even mentions what she has gone through. She gives the dry place to her child and sleeps in the dump herself. For 3 years she nourishes the body with milk, which is transformed from the blood of her own body. Parents continually instruct and guide their children in the ways of propriety and morality as the youngsters mature into adults. They arrange marriages for them and provide them with property and wealth or devise ways to get it for them. They take this responsibility and trouble upon themselves with tremendous zeal and toil, never sneaking about their care and kindness. When a son or daughter becomes ill, parents are worried and afraid to the point that they may even grow ill themselves. They remain by the child, as side providing constant care, and only when the child gets well are the parents happy once again. In this way, they care for and raise their children with the sustained hope that their offspring will soon grow to be mature adults. How sad that all too often the children are unfilial in return. In speaking with relatives whom they should honor, the children display no compliance. When they ought to be polite, they have no manners. They glare at those whom they should venerate, and insult their uncles and aunts. They scold their siblings and destroy any family feeling that might have existed among them. Children like that have no respect or sense of propriety. Children may be well taught, but if they are unfilial, they will not heed the instructions or obey the rules. Rarely will they rely upon the guidance of their parents. They are contrary and rebellious when interacting with their brothers. They come and go from home without ever reporting to their parents. Their speech and actions are very arrogant and they act on impulse without consulting others. Such children ignore the admonitions and punishments set down by their parents and pay no regard to their uncles' warnings. Yet, at the same time, they are immature and always need to be looked after and protected by their elders. As such children grow up, they become more and more obstinate and uncontrollable. They are entirely ungrateful and totally contrary. They are defiant and hateful, rejecting both family and friends. They befriend evil people and under their influence soon adopt the same kinds of bad habits. They tend to take what is false to be true. Such children may be enticed by others to leave their families and run away to live in other towns, thus denouncing their parents and rejecting their native town. They may become salesmen or civil servants who languish in comfort and luxury. They may marry in haste and that new bond provides yet another distraction which prevents them from returning home for long periods of time. Or, in going to live in other towns, these children may be incautious and find themselves plotted against or accused of doing evil. They may be unfairly locked up in prison. or they may meet with illness and become enmeshed in disasters and hardships, subject to the terrible pain of poverty, starvation, and emaciation. Yet no one there will care for them. Being scorned and disliked by others, they will be abandoned on the street. In such circumstances, their lives may come to an end. No one bothers to try to save them. Their bodies swell up, rot, decay, and are exposed to the sun and blown away by the wind. The white bones entirely disintegrate and scatter as these children come to their final rest in the dirt of some other town. These children will never again have a happy reunion with their relatives and kin. Nor will they ever know how their aging parents mourn for and worry about them. The parents may grow blind from weeping or become sick from extreme grief and despair. Constantly dwelling on the memory of their children, they may pass away, but even when they become ghosts, their souls still cling to this attachment and are unable to let it go. Others of these unfilial children may not aspire to learning, but instead become interested in strange and bizarre doctrines. Such children may be villainous, coarse, and stubborn, delighting in practices that are utterly devoid of benefit. They may become involved in fights and thefts, setting themselves at odds with the town by drinking and gambling. As if their own debauchery were not enough, they drag their brothers into it as well, to the further distress of their parents. If such children do live at home, they leave early in the morning and do not return until late at night. Never do they ask about the welfare of their parents or make sure that they do not suffer from heat or cold. They do not inquire after their parents' well-being in the morning or in the evening, nor even on the 1st and 15th of the lunar month. In fact, it never occurs to these unfilial children to ever ask whether their parents have slept comfortably or rested peacefully. Such children are simply not concerned in the least about their parents' well-being. When the parents of such children grow old and their appearance becomes more and more withered and emaciated, they are made to feel ashamed to be seen in public and are subjected to abuse and oppression. Such unfilial children may end up with a father who is a widower or a mother who is a widow. The solitary parents are left alone in empty houses, feeling like guests in their own homes. They may endure cold and hunger, but no one takes heed of their plight. They may weep incessantly from morning to night, sighing and lamenting. It's only right that children should provide for aging parents with food and drink of delicious flavors, but irresponsible children are sure to overlook their duties. If they ever do attempt to help their parents out in any way, they feel embarrassed and afraid that people will laugh at them. Yet, such offspring may lavish wealth and food on their own wives and children, disregarding the toil and weariness involved in doing so. Other unfilial offspring may be so intimidated by their wives that they go along with all of their wives. But when appealed to by their parents and elders, they ignore them and are totally unfazed by their pleas. It may be the case that daughters were quite filial to their parents before their own marriages, but that they become progressively rebellious after they marry. This situation may be so extreme that if their parents show even the slightest signs of displeasure, the daughters become hateful and vengeful toward them. Yet they bear their husband's scolding and beatings with sweet tempers, even though their spouses are outsiders with other surnames and family ties. The emotional bonds between such couples are deeply entangled, and yet those daughters hold their parents at a distance. They may follow their husbands and move to other towns, leaving their parents behind entirely. They do not long for them and simply cut off all communication with them. When the parents continue to hear no word from their daughters, they feel incessant anxiety. They become so fraught with sorrow that it is as if they were suspended upside down. Their every thought is of seeing their children, just as one who is thirsty longs for something to drink. Their kind thoughts for their offspring never cease. The virtue of one, as parents, kindness is boundless and limitless. If one has made this mistake of being unfilial, how difficult it is to repay that kindness. At that time, upon hearing the Buddha, for speak about the depth of one's parents' kindness, everyone in the great assembly threw themselves on the ground and began beating their chests and striking themselves until all their hair pores flowed with blood. Some fell unconscious to the ground, while others stamped their feet in grief. It was a long time before they could control themselves. With loud voices they lamented, "Such suffering! What suffering! How painful! How painful! We are all offenders. We are criminals who have never awakened, like those who travel in a dark night. We have just now understood our offenses and our very insides are torn to bits. We only hope that the word honored one will pity us and save us. Please tell us how we can repay the deep kindness of our parents." At that time the Tathagata,如来, used eight kinds of profoundly deep and pure voices to speak to the assembly. All of you should know this. I will now explain for you the various aspects of this matter. If there were a person who carried his father on his left shoulder and his mother on his right shoulder until his bones were ground to powder by their weight as they bore through to the marrow, and if that person were to circumambulate Mount Subaru, Xu Yi, for 100,000 kalpas, until the blood that flowed out from his feet covered his ankles, that person would still not have repaid the deep kindness of his parents. If there were a person who, during the period of a kalpa, jie, fraught with famine and starvation, sliced the flesh of his own body to feed his parents and did this as many times as there are dust motes as he passed through hundreds of thousands of kalpas, jie, that person still would not have repaid the deep kindness of his parents. If there were a person who, for the sake of his parents, took a sharp knife and cut out his eyes and made an offering of them to the Tathagatas, and continued to do that for hundreds of thousands of kalpas, jie, that person still would not have repaid the deep kindness of his parents. If there were a person who, for the sake of his father and mother, used a sharp knife to cut out his heart and liver so that the blood flowed and covered the ground, and if he continued in this way to do this for hundreds of thousands of kalpas, jie, never once complaining about the pain, that person still would not have repaid the deep kindness of his parents. If there were a person who, for the sake of his parents, took 100,000 swords and stabbed his body with them all at once so that they entered one side and came out the other, and if he continued in this way to do this for hundreds of thousands of kalpas, jie, that person still would not have repaid the deep kindness of his parents. If there were a person who, for the sake of his parents, beat his bones down to the marrow and continued in this way to do this for hundreds of thousands of kalpas, jie, that person still would not have repaid the deep kindness of his parents. If there were a person who, for the sake of his parents, swallowed molten iron pellets and continued in this way to do this for hundreds of thousands of kalpas, jie, that person still would not have repaid the deep kindness of his parents. At that time, upon hearing the Buddha, Pho, speak about the kindness and virtue of parents, everyone in the great assembly wept silently and felt a searing pain in their hearts. They reflected deeply, simultaneously brought forth shame and said to the Buddha, Pho, world honored one, Shizun, how can we repay the deep kindness of our parents? The Buddha, Pho, replied, disciples of the Buddha, if you wish to repay your parents' kindness, write out this sutra, Jing, on their behalf. Recite this sutra, Jing, on their behalf. Repent of transgressions and offenses on their behalf. For the sake of your parents, make offerings to the triple jewel, Sampa. For the sake of your parents, hold the precept of pure eating. For the sake of your parents, practice giving and cultivate blessings. If you are able to do these things, you are being a filial child. If you do not do these things, you are a person destined for the hells. The Buddha, Pho, told Amanda, Anand, if a person is not filial, when his life ends and his body decays, he will fall in the spaceless, abyssal hell, 阿鼻无间地狱. This great hell is 80,000 yojanas, 有许, in circumstance and is surrounded on all four sides by iron walls. Above, it is covered over by nets, and the ground is also made of iron. And mass of fire burns fiercely, while thunder roars and bright bolts of lightning set things afire. Molten brass and iron fluids are poured over the offenders' bodies. Brass dogs and iron snakes constantly spew out fire and smoke, which burns the offenders and broils their flesh and fat to a pulp. Oh, such suffering! Difficult to take, difficult to bear. There are poles, hooks, spears and lances, iron halberds and iron chains, iron hammers, and iron bolts. Wheels of iron knives ran down from the air. The offender is chopped, hacked, or stabbed, and undergoes these cruel punishments for culpas, jie, without respite. Then they enter the remaining hells, where their heads are capped with fiery basins, while iron wheels roll over their bodies, passing both horizontally and vertically until their guts are ripped open and their bones and flesh are squashed to a pulp. Within a single day, they experience myriad births and myriad deaths. Such sufferings are a result of committing the five rebellious acts and of being unfilial when one was alive. At that time, upon hearing the Buddha, Fo, speak about the virtue of parents, kindness, everyone in the great assembly wept sorrowfully and addressed the Tathagata, Ru Lai, on this day. How can we repay the deep kindness of our parents? The Buddha, Fo, said, disciples of the Buddha, if you wish to repay their kindness, then for the sake of your parents bring this sutra, Jing. This is truly repaying their kindness. If one can print one copy, then one will get to see on Buddha. If one can print 10 copies, then one will get to see 10 Buddhas. If one can print 100 copies, then one will get to see 100 Buddhas. If one can print 1,000 copies, then one will get to see 1,000 Buddhas. If one can print 10,000 copies, then one will get to see 10,000 Buddhas. This is the power derived when good people print sutras. All Buddhas will forever protect such people with their kindness and can immediately cause the parents of such people to be reborn in the heavens, to enjoy all kinds of happiness, and to leave behind the sufferings of the hells. At that time, Ananda, Anan, and the rest of the great assembly, Da Zhong, the Asuras, Asyodhua, Garudas, Jalodhua, Kinaras, Jinnadhua, Mahoragas, Mahoragya, people, Ren, Nam, people, Feiren, and others, as well as the gods, Tianren, dragons, Longzhong, Yakshas, Yecha, Gandharvas, Gandhapo, Wheel, turning sage kings, Zhuanlun Shen Wang, and all the lesser kings, Zhu Xiao Wang, felt all the hairs on their bodies stand on end when they heard what the Buddha, Fo, had said. They wept grievously and were unable to stop themselves. Each one of them made a vow saying, all of us, from now until the exhaustion of the bounds of the future, would rather than our bodies be pulverized into small particles of dust for 800,000 kalpas, 劫, than to ever go against the Tathagata, as sagely teachings, 如来圣教。We would rather that our tongues be plucked out, so that they would extend for a full yojana, and that for 800,000 kalpas, 劫, an iron plow would run over them. We would rather have 800,000 bladed wheel roll freely over our bodies, than ever go against the Tathagata, as sagely teachings, 如来圣教。We would rather that our bodies be ensnared in an iron net for 800,000 kalpas, 劫, than ever go against the Tathagata, as sagely teachings, 如来圣教。We would rather that for 800,000 kalpas, 劫, our bodies would be chopped, hacked, mutilated,and chiseled into 10,000,000 pieces so that our skin, flesh, joints, and bones would be completely disintegrated, than ever go against the Tathagata, as sagely teachings, 如来圣教。At that time, Amanda, Anand, with dignity and a sense of peace, rose from his seat and asked the Buddha,For, word honored one, 世尊, what man shall this sutra have when we accord with it and uphold it? The Buddha, for, told Amanda, Anand, this sutra is called the sutra about the deep kindness of parents and the difficulty of repaying it, 父母恩重难报经。Use this name when you accord with it and uphold it. At that time, the great assembly, the gods, 天, humans, 人, asuras, 阿修罗, and the others, hearing what the Buddha, 佛, had said, were completely delighted. They believed it, received it, and offered up their conduct in accord with it.And then bowed and withdrew. http://www.namomatap.net/n/publication/filialpitisutra/filialpitisutra-n.htm